probably the greatest Polish fighting force in World War II, the Second Polish Corps, is another story. As is what is one of the most heinous crimes against humanity committed during that period, cutting. Not only was the crime heinous, but there is a widely held and growing perception that the Western Allies' long-lasting reaction was shameful. The perception being that the United Kingdom, the United States of America, and most of the remaining allies sacrificed integrity and ethics for political expediency, keeping up a pretense despite overwhelming proof, and not proclaiming or even accepting Soviet guilt until Glasnost and the Gorbachev-Yeltsin period, when the Soviets finally admitted responsibility themselves. The degree of accuracy regarding the perception is actually irrelevant, because the fact remains that the perception exists. The majority of politicians and historians may have acted in the way that they did, but the armed forces and people of Great Britain did not. The bonds of friendship formed during those dark days of World War II have endured for over 70 years and shown no signs of fading. If anything, they continue to develop further, especially since Poland joined the European Union and became a member of NATO. General Sikorski made numerous trips to many countries, both visiting Polish units and meeting probably all of the most important and influential political leaders of the Alliance, always fighting for the Polish cause. He continually utilized his diplomatic talents and influencing skills. On the 4th of July 1943, returning from inspecting Polish troops, his plane crashed on takeoff from Gibraltar, killing everyone on board except pilot. Sikorski died at the very moment when his country most needed his help in the difficult situation in which it found itself after the failure of the Polish-Russian agreement. His death meant an irreparable loss to Poland. However, Sikorski's principles, his methods of political action, and his character remained an example for all to follow. He knew the difficult art of distinguishing between the position of a politician and a soldier, always finding the right balance between the two. He was a great believer in law and exactly legal strategies, and a practical and realistic man, ready to interpret a situation and to compromise between theory and practice. As a politician, he was a statesman without obsessions. He never looked back on the past, but preferred to look forward to a brighter future. Sikorski combined in his character all that was best in the Polish nation. He understood not only his own people, but he envisaged the world of the future as well. That was the reason why he so easily found support in carrying out his ideas. And in Great Britain, he made many friends amongst politicians of all parties. He moved the times in social as well as in international questions. Władysław Sikorski bequeathed much to those he left behind, and the fact that Poland's name and prowess became famous during the war was largely due to him. Great Britain lost in him a great friend and one of the champions of a just and wise world policy. We're here to commemorate and remember the achievements and untimely death of this great leader. Formal records are, of course, extremely important and tell us about political theories and activities, the size and strength of armies, military strategy, the outcome of battle. Such information is vital. Yet to fully appreciate the history of World War II and those who figure in it, we must try and understand the human face of that time. Loss of comrades, extreme conditions, barbaric deeds, betrayal, intense Kuszka, aged 41, and hundreds of others who remain here far from their motherland. How many of my countrymen living in Poland remember that there are nearly 400 other sons and one daughter of Poland who are also buried here in Europe? As penned in a famous poem of the First World War in Flanders Field, from which I quote, "Take up the quarrel with the foe. To you from failing hands we throw the torch, be yours to hold it high. If you break faith with us who die, we shall not sleep, though poppies grow in Flanders Fields." They did take up the torch, kept so brightly lit by General Sikorsky, and kept the faith. But a lot tragically fell, not only here in Great Britain, but on all fronts, both in the west and in the east. Monte Cassino, Falaise, Arm, the Battle of the Atlantic, Berlin, are all symbols of the sacrifice. After the war, that sacrifice for freedom and independence continued. Here in the freeway,